Only when I told them about the HIV status of my child, they told me he died, and I killed him.
Some of the mines have reported that they anticipate from their research that probably 45%, maybe even up to 50% of their workers are HIV positive.
Amongst us as Africans, black men, there are those who are even permitted within their own cultural groups to say to his wife, I'm going to a certain wedding and there are going to be girls there. I'm going to be proposing love to these girls.
One in three women who goes to an antenatal clinic, one in three pregnant women is HIV positive.
10 million people in South Africa would die from AIDS.
Sydafrikas mere end 40 millioner indbyggere er i dag truet af en AIDS-epidemi, der spredes med en mareridtsagtig hastighed. Epidemiens virkelige omfang var først langsomt ved at gå op for befolkningen, der knap er kommet sig oven på apartheid-regimes terror.
According to research from the University of Natal in Durban, in 10 years' time, our average life expectancy is going to be 35. It's now sitting at 57. 35 in 10 years' time.
Probably the greatest impact will be the fact that the people most affected by HIV are the richest of the poor. They're not the poorest people in the country, but they're people who come from disadvantaged and socially disrupted backgrounds, but who themselves have some social mobility. That's our emerging middle class. That's the backbone of the development of the future of South Africa.
I'm sure as people start getting sick and start dying, people will start to change their behavior because they see people around them dying from HIV. But unfortunately, I don't think people are going to change their behavior until then.
Vi forlader Johannesburg og besøger et af landets få centre for forældreløse HIV-positive børn for at tage pulsen på, hvad der venter Sydafrika forude. På hjemmet kan børnene få en værdig død.
His condition is much better now. He's been having diarrhea and vomiting, so that's why we have given. He's much better. Probably tomorrow he'll go back to heaven.
Projected figure, I think by the year 2010, is that 5 million South African children under the age of 15 will be orphaned as a direct result of AIDS.
They don't go beyond 6 years, you see. Nobody reaches six.
This little girl is called Victoria, and she was found in the gutter. And the only thing we know about Victoria is that she had a little plastic container with some milk powder in and her name, Victoria. All the children you see in this room are HIV positive. All are abandoned or orphaned. If a child was abandoned or orphaned for whatever reasons, particularly with the death of parents, they were absorbed into the traditional African traditional family, extended family. That family throughout Africa is dying for many different reasons. So the natural safety net is no longer there. We try to get as many into foster and adoption situations as we can, but we're dealing with a few children. If you scale it up nationally, where you're dealing with millions, how are we going to do it when 25% of the workforce is going to die and the impact of that death on our economy, the ability to produce, the ability to compete? What's going to happen to the ever-narrowing tax base? How is the government going to pay for health, welfare, education, and the things that people need?
Et lille håb er der dog forude med opdagelsen af Nevirapine, en ny type billig AIDS-medicin.
The results from the Uganda study on Nevirapine were very exciting. It showed around 50% reduction in HIV transmission. That's a good result, and I think very promising.
when the baby is born with the fluids and the blood in the birth canal, there's approximately a 60% chance that the baby can, from the bloods and the fluids, become positive. If you use nevirapine, what you do is you give a teaspoonful of nevirapine to the baby 3 days after the baby's birth. That costs 24 rand.
We must now start planning to go ahead, implement a national program, certainly in South Africa, and make sure that women who are HIV positive and pregnant can get the drug. Otherwise, you know, we're just condemning more and more children to be born with HIV.
Er der nogen specielle grunde til, at Sydafrika er det sted i verden, hvor AIDS-epidemien spredes hurtigst?
There's emerging evidence that the type of virus we get in sub-Saharan Africa is more easily transmissible through normal heterosexual sex than the type that we get in the US and Europe. So there may be very important biological reasons why the epidemic is moving so much faster in these areas.
En række andre faktorer er med til at gøde jorden for AIDS-epidemien.
The epidemic in our part of the world is not by chance, it's not by bad luck. It is very, very determined by social factors, economic, political, historical factors as well. I think trying to develop medications is a necessity, definitely. There's a role to be played in that, and a very critical role. But at the end of the day, the real solution is social and economic stability. You have got very large numbers of, especially men, migrating and moving around the country around work usually. And with that, there's a whole sexual subculture which follows it. It's to do with sex, it's to do with alcohol, it's to do with shabins, pubs, taverns, if you like, people who are very unhappy, basically very unfulfilled, and seeking to get their gratification, their intimacy through sex, especially.
Women they're very underpowered. So they're not in a position to tell men, well, you have to use a condom, because then the man will hit them, throw them out the house, whatever, force them to have sex without a condom. A situation with very patriarchal societies, a lot of poverty, a lot of illiteracy. I think, you know, those are very common factors that lead to the spread of HIV.
As a man, I can say, you know, South African men are very greedy men. They are hungry men. I don't know, maybe it's the kind of food that we eat as African men. But all in all, it doesn't mean a person must lose his morals. I have buried a few. A few of those people, I'd be saying that they used to be very much in demand in terms of women. The other thing which you need to know, South African women, especially black women, if a guy or a man is going out with a lot of women, everybody wants to go there and taste. They want to go out with that particular person. And this is how this disease is being spread so easily. And there are quite a lot of people who are positive there, but they are not coming out in the open. With us, AIDS, I think, is still something which is regarded as a sin.
Et andet sted i slumbyen Alexandra diskuterer en gruppe kvinder det kvindelige kondom.
Just imagine I'm busy holding. My husband is so hot. He can't wait for me to hold.
Small girls go around with older men for money. And they have more partners. So I think poverty is the main problem. That's why the disease is spreading so much.
Kvinderne har meldt sig frivilligt til at undervise og hjælpe HIV-positive og AIDS-syge Alexandra. En af dem fortæller om et generelt problem i townshipen.
People here in Alexandra, there are those people who are living in one room as a family. Mommy, daddy and children in the house. So when the parents sleep during the night, the children, they see that, and then, you know, they learn to sleep around at a tender age. I mean, you cannot blame the children. They see their daddy and mommy doing it. So they think it's kind of cool. And then they want to do it also. So it's a problem of privacy. There's no privacy in our community.
På AIDS-afdelingen i Baragwanath Hospitalet i Soweto arbejder Florence Ngubani som AIDS-rådgiver. Hun er selv HIV-positiv og har mistet sit barn, som følge af virusen. Nu passer hun andres HIV-positive babyer.
I would rather wait for a cure than to bring another child to suffer. I've seen what I've seen, and I don't imagine myself bringing any other child to come and suffer because of my own reasons. The reason why I think others are still infecting other people purposely is because there's a saying that I won't die alone, and why should I die near somebody gave it to me?
Florence blev smittet af sin kæreste, som døde før barnet. Selv blev hun først sent klar over sin status.
Well, I find it late because by the time I find out my child was sick, and I find it through my child. And when I went to report to tell, because I wasn't staying with him, I stayed with my parents, and the aim was that I must come back after 3 months to see him. So when I came back, he wasn't there, and they didn't tell me where he was. Only when I told them about the HIV status of my child, they told me he died, and I killed him.
En anden kulturbestemt spredningsfaktor er myten om, at AIDS kan kureres ved at gå i seng med en jomfru. Mange spædbørn bliver voldtaget på grund af myten.
I think we're facing a rape situation and a sick community whereby people believe that when you sleep with a virgin, or a child, you'll be cured of AIDS. And that's something that we need to look at. Whether can we put more money into educating people that whatever they're thinking is right is wrong, and which is a bit difficult at the moment because we already faced with the situation of educating people to use condoms. So what I normally encourage people when I give talks in schools or church, or when I talk to people individually, is that whenever they know that somebody's being raped, they must report the cases before 24 hours.
Et sådan tilfælde er journalisten Charlene Smith. Hun valgte at offentliggøre sin egen voldtægt.
On April the 1st this year, it was the first day of the Easter weekend, it was a Thursday. I'd been on to a business meeting. I'd left here at 6:30 in the evening. I got back at round about 8:30. I've got 3 dogs. Well, at the time I had 3 dogs. The dogs looked as though everything was fine because we all worry about hijacking here. I came into the house. I was preoccupied thinking about work. Locked the doors. Noticed that there seemed to be more lights on than when I'd left. There was a jacket lying in the middle of the living room floor. And I thought it seemed strange, but I thought my son might have come home and got warmer clothing because he was going to movies with friends. Went to the bathroom. As I turned to flush the toilet, this guy appeared in the doorway. I started screaming because I thought that was the thing that I should do. He held up the knife and said, "I've got a knife," grabbed me by the arm, pulled me out. Demanded money. I didn't have money. Bound my hands behind my back with masking tape. Then said we were going to have sex. Pushed me onto the bed, removed my lower garments, and began raping me. Although at the very beginning, I said to him, I said, "I have AIDS," because I'd heard of another woman who'd said that, and they'd left her alone. And he said, "Doesn't matter, I'll use a condom," which he didn't.
Det lykkedes for Charlene at undslippe forbryderen, og efter meget besvær at få fat i medicinet AZT til en pris af over 5.000 kroner. Hun besluttede sig for at kæmpe for alle voldtægtsoffres rettigheder.
What makes me very angry is that the majority of women and children who get raped in this country are black, and there's no ways that they can afford that money.
Sydafrika har en af de højeste voldtægtsrater i verden.
Because I'm a journalist, I was aware of the fact that in South Africa a woman or child is raped every 26 seconds, that in this country 43 million people, a million women and children and some men and boys children are raped each year.
Charlene Smith modtog årets journalistpris i Sydafrika for sine artikler om voldtægt og AIDS. Hun ser en klar sammenhæng imellem de mange voldtægter og den hurtige spredning af AIDS.
In South Africa, the rape graph goes up at age 11, according to the latest statistics released in March, and peaks at age 13 and remains there until age 25, and then starts dropping. I was somewhere down right at the bottom. But I think that it's no coincidence that the rate of HIV is highest among young girls aged 15 to 25. I don't think that's a coincidence.
At voldtægter og AIDS hører sammen, understreges af det uhyggelige fænomen gruppevoldtægt.
75% of rapes in South Africa are committed by anything from 3 to 30 people at a time. However, if you're raped by a single perpetrator, he's more likely to kill you. But we have a culture here where young men will ask out a woman on a date or ask her to sleep with him. And if she refuses, then they and their friends teach her a lesson and they go and rape her.
Charlene ved stadigvæk ikke med 100% sikkerhed, hvorvidt hun er HIV-positiv. Meget få mennesker står frem på grund af diskrimineringen fra omgivelserne.
I feel that I'm the luckiest person. When I say luckiest, because my family understands, my friends understand, my colleagues understand. I've never had a problem of disclosing to anybody about my HIV status. But most people that I've seen and I'm seeing every day, they're facing a different situation. So it breaks my heart most of the time to know and to see people who are HIV suffering because they can't disclose. Either if they disclose, they're kicked out of their houses or lose their jobs.
There's huge discrimination against people on the basis of HIV. I mean, the discrimination is so great that very, very few people in South Africa are open about their HIV status or about the fact that they have AIDS. And it ranges from the most extreme violence against people with HIV, such as the killing of a member of NAPWHA in December of last year, to everyday abuses of people's dignity, for example, refusing to give a person a job, refusing schooling to a young child with HIV.
Mark Haywood er leder af et advokatkontor, der arbejder med AIDS-diskriminering. Han giver et typisk eksempel på diskrimination.
One of the common cases that we find ourselves dealing with is where a domestic worker has been taken by her employer to a doctor, tested for HIV without her knowledge, usually. The information about her HIV status is told not to her, but to her employer, and she then learns her HIV status at the same time as being dismissed, being sacked, and losing accommodation and losing all kinds of security.
Sydafrika har i de seneste årtier gennemgået en voldsom urbanisering. Migrationen fra apartheidårene, familieopsplitningen og voksende slumområder er med til at sprede AIDS. Men AIDS florerer også på landet i det sydlige Afrika. I det tyndt befolkede naboland, Namibia, er AIDS for alvor ved at komme på dagsordenen.
When I told Roger to put on a condom, he said he didn't want to because he doesn't eat the chocolate with the wrapper. And I told him, lie back, I'll do all the work and I'll show you how good it can taste. And you know what? I think he liked it.
Janine knows how to get a man to wear a condom.
Det er ikke kun på TV, der bliver talt om AIDS. Her ses Sam Nujoma, Namibias præsident, til en AIDS-konference. Blandt publikum ses også Wilhelm Lucas, der indtil for nylig var en af de få namibier, der har stået offentligt frem med sin sygdom.
Stay out of sex. You have lots of time after age 30.
I don't think in Namibia I will find somebody who are 30 years, but he didn't even trying sex, doing sex. I don't think that it will work. What do we have to do just to protect ourselves?
Sundhedsministerens gode råd til ungdommen er ikke ment som en vittighed. Senere kommer hun dog også ind på brugen af kondomer.
The people were advised to abstain from sex, be faithful to one partner, and if they could not manage the latter, they could use condoms. This message seemed to have fallen on deaf ears because Namibians are getting infected daily at an alarming rate.
For Lucas har det stor betydning, at præsidenten tager emnet alvorligt og udtaler sig offentligt om AIDS.
The epidemic is going to spread like the proverbial bushfire. As such, metaphorically speaking, that grass on our landscape was already dry and conducive for the rapid spread of fire of HIV/AIDS infection.
Et lille indirekte skulderklap for præsidenten er heller ikke af vejen.
Some individuals have openly shared their HIV-positive status with the public and have thereby helped to give the epidemic in Namibia the necessary exposure.
Skulderklappet er helt på sin plads. Wilhelm Lucas har sammen med andre oplyst befolkningen i det nordlige Namibia om AIDS i flere år. Her er gruppen på skolebesøg. Den kvindelige skoleleder lytter med stor interesse til Lukas og til elevernes spørgsmål og kommentarer. Mange af skoleeleverne har aldrig set et kondom før. Lidt senere spørger skolelederen eleverne om, hvor mange af dem, der ønsker kondomer.
If we don't educate our small ones, who is going to be the leader of tomorrow? We are not going to have leaders in the future. So you cannot, parents cannot tell, come here and tell me my children doesn't involve in sex. But because of human children right, if they, it's their right. It's nowadays they have to decide it themselves whether they go for condom or not. Because as I have said that it doesn't matter, you don't give them condoms. Most of the kids, they are involved in sex.
Ikke langt fra skolen går begravelsesforretningen Stryne.
Ja, unene nga sha kunjuka. Maso wene ga kunjuka unene ohaketwa komkithiko 8. Ka unene kwijipara ma kunjuka.
En lokal læge understreger med chokerende tal, at antallet af begravelser fremover vil stige.
We obviously testing 100 people per day, where at least some 40 people to 50 people become positive.
Der er folk nok, der hævder at kunne kurere AIDS. En såkaldt traditional healer, har slået sig ned ved landevejen en times kørsel syd fra byen Osakati.
They can provide medicine, a person can drink such a medicine, or they can apply medicine, from there they will feel better, but does not mean that the virus is cured. Virus still in the body, only that what is cured is just the optimistic disease. I used to have many, many friends, but by the time I started telling friends that I'm HIV positive, many of them, they have just no. We don't like to stay with you anymore, to be as a friend anymore, because you are HIV positive. Yeah, at the moment, my family really accept me. Although some are, again, not all of them, I cannot say all of them, they accepted me, but many of them, they have accepted. In Namibia, many people, they are so very Christians, and they belong to church, something like that. And they feel using condom is a sin. And on the other hand, they think that telling people to how to use a condom in the community is a part of influencing people, encouraging especially youth to be sexually active.
Et andet problem er mindst lige så kulturelt betinget.
Our forefather used to have more than 5 wives, and they, by that time the disease was not there. When it comes to the nowadays, they also think, if you are talking about this prevention, like please stick to one pattern, they can tell that, they can even ask you and tell that no, you are wrong. Even our forefather used to have more than 5 wives, but the disease was not there.
Lucas er for længst flyttet hjemmefra, men hans mor har aldrig helt lært at leve med sønnens sygdom.
Ngame handi iturashi keme galikana yoko galikana na twa hiya kyangaka boka ina mbuto ya kyangaka ushoka kungae oshimpu oshidiu no hekana ndo etenda fa umaje afara kesi wanjewe ndino ruho du nene ndio etara fa afiganjepu onke handi ntura ko shipara shakarunga.
Langt fra alle mennesker tager imod gode råd fra Lukas og AIDS-oplysningsgruppen.
People are still ignoring this disease. If you and they don't want even together, even you invite them to come to the meeting so that you can teach them, you will only have few people.
Derfor tager Lukas ud til landsdelens konge for at bede om hjælp. Kongen bor langt ude i bushen.
Under det kunne jeg sige mig, og hvordan kunne jeg sige mig, så kan jeg sige mig, så ya non due te pa pa popso ke shini on kambadara di kendi no wa kambadara na doku eri tiran tu kwa faturi ra warongo shimo shine ne sasuman unene no kuri o shima shina choko konji sa unjuro no kisingu no wa itsa kashi shishom to gume.
Kongen har en opfordring til det namibiske folk.
Nu kukara sana nonkara sana mbanawa na antu yetu mbono da Monica ya kwatwa kumputo ya changaka ukwe ya kwathira ngere mosi kura ngere mpumbu mwengaza adikendo ya pumbu kukwathirwa toa akari pe ya tonda osho kukara pe ya fatu ya tonda neno taku uvisise upla kazi wa changao o unene hasifiliku mpa azira zire okui nando kui dipa no sho maswa gete o karo kwa changa omoro kwa azimbrura kucha okwafa ke niwe na nae anto afa imtara ko kucha ye ina pumbi wawe.
Vi forlader kongen og vender tilbage til Sydafrika. for at rette blikket imod de multinationale medicinalfirmaers ansvar i tragedien.
Our country and continent faces a holocaust simply because we are poor and cannot afford the latest medications.
We've got 3.5 million South Africans who have HIV. 99% of those people probably have a monthly income of less than 1,000 rand a month. At present world market prices, a month's antiretroviral drug costs 5,000 rand per month. So it is just way beyond the affordability, the possibility of access to ordinary South Africans. What that means is that most South Africans with HIV will die of AIDS. That is the fact. We will see hundreds of thousands and eventually millions of AIDS-related deaths in the next decade. And that is happening at a time when internationally and in richer countries like the United States and in European countries, for the first time in this epidemic, the number of AIDS-related deaths has begun to decline. And it is declining because people have uniform, well, I wouldn't say uniform, but generally people have access to reasonable treatment and to advanced therapies.
The one thing is that people know that I'm living with AIDS, and they find it amazing that I can make it, and I'm even gaining weight, and I'm cheerful and happy every day. But part of that is because I have treatment, and a lot of people who are HIV positive don't have antiretrovirus.
Et af medicinalfirmaerne, Glaxo Welcome, lever ifølge Mark Haywood ikke op til sit etiske ansvar. Firmaet har afdelinger i mange af verdens lande.
In South Africa, we have about 40,000 infants a year being born with HIV. So if we can get hold of a drug that can cut that by 20,000, then we need that drug, and we need it yesterday. But AZT has been around for a long time, and Glaxo has made its money on AZT many, many times over in the last few years. Glaxo is a hugely rich multinational company. The chairperson of Glaxo, somebody called Sir Richard Sykes, who's I think based in London, was paid £1.86 million in 1998. That's almost 20 million rand, which is one quarter of the cost that it would cost South Africa, one quarter of the amount that it would cost South Africa to implement AZT for all pregnant women in this country, and to pay not only for the cost of the drug itself, but also for setting up the counseling services, the HIV testing, the follow-up, and so on and so on. So it's perverse, it's obscene, frankly. And the fact that this company holds on to its insistence that it must make profits on these drugs is very, very sad.
Trummen er Afrikas budbringer. Budskabet om troskab, kondomer eller afholdenhed skal ud til alle og skal efterleves. Ellers venter døden. Trummen sender samtidig et budskab til den nordlige halvkugle om at komme til undsætning og sørge for billig og virksom medicin til alle smittede. Det haster.
From a purely moral and ethical point of view, it's incumbent on the entire international community to try and find solutions to this terrible infection and this epidemic, just on a moral level. But I think one can argue on an economic and developmental level that it has the potential to destabilize many, many countries, not only in Africa, but throughout Asia as well. And I think as we become more and more global village, an integrated global village, a large amount of instability in any one area threatens the stability of the entire system. So I think the entire international community has a responsibility and a role to try and find solutions. I don't think Africa is particularly overpopulated anyways.
AIDS løser under ingen omstændigheder overbefolkningsproblemer. Epidemien øger fattigdommen, og fattigdom er den vigtigste enkeltfaktor, der skaber overbefolkning. Men måske kan epidemien alligevel bruges til noget.
Look at this in the way that a business person would look at a terrible crisis or a challenge. Say, okay, we have this terrible problem, but this is an opportunity. And the opportunity is this: we have the worst rape statistics in the world. We have the highest accelerating incidence of HIV in the world. If we look at measures to combat that and to do something good with that, we could do cutting-edge research, we could become the world's best country in terms of combating sexual violence, in terms of the medical care, in terms of the drugs that we give people, in terms of the policing techniques, in terms of our laws. We must see this as an opportunity. We had apartheid, one of the world's worst, most discriminatory systems. What did we do? We saw it as an opportunity. We turned it around. We now have in place one of the best constitutions in the world.
Sydafrika er endnu engang blevet dybt involveret i en kamp for befolkningens eksistens. Kampen vil koste millioner af ofre og medføre kulturelle forandringer. Kampen bliver hård, og den vil tage tid.
Moral values in South Africa could easily be introduced to the communities, but it's also very difficult, especially from a black man's point of view. You know, we don't easily discuss sex with the children. We don't discuss sex with our elders. So that's where the barrier is. So now lately at schools, they are trying to introduce that slowly, but I don't know how long is it going to take. It's quite some time. It will take some time.